Hi everybody. It's been a few weeks since I put anything on video. It's not that I haven't been busy. I just haven't spent much time down here in the basement shop, and what time I have been spending down here, I've actually been spending trying to clean up. You might not believe it looking at the place, but the reality is I spent a lot of time moving stuff around on the other side over there where I plan to eventually put this workbench. And so I'm trying to make room over there and get everything over there straightened out the way I want it to be, so that I can then free up this space in here so I can move my mill to where I want it to finally sit, because I don't want the mill over there. And once I get the mill moved, then I'll do some more permanent wiring and get things straightened out. But today, I think I got some time. I wanted to play around with the Vernon lathe because I haven't fired that thing up and done anything in a while. And I had a little project I wanted to, a little video I wanted to do talking about setting the center height of the cutting tool tip, and saw some different ways that that's been done on YouTube. And I wanted to play around with my own idea on how to go about it and see whether or not it's actually that accurate. Then, once I have an easy way to set the center height of the tool, I can actually start looking at some more of the carbide inserts that I have and some of the other holders that I have, seeing what tips I have that will fit in what holders and which ones I can actually use and which ones I can just basically get rid of. But right now, my problem is, as you might not have noticed, I am not using my lapel microphone. And the reason why I'm not using the lapel microphone is because the last video series I did, which was a three-part series on some flea market finds, and I finished with part three, which was the Mitutoyo thread micrometer that I bought. In all three of those videos, the audio was bad. You may or may not have noticed it. What I ended up having to do is post-production in editing in the iMovie software. I had to go in and use the reduced background noise level feature on every single clip in order to get rid of a very annoying audible hiss or static. And I don't know where that came from. And the weird thing is that just prior to doing part one of that series, I finished up, I think, talking about the Delta planer. And I think I did that video like literally right before I did the other one. So I literally wrapped up with the Delta planer, cleaned the you know, spot on the workbench, moved the planer out of the way, and moved the tripod from one location to another, and picked up where I started off with the new series there. And then, much to my dismay, of course, I did the whole series before I realized that the audio was bad. And I was like, you gotta be kidding me. All I did was move the thing from point A to point B. So today I noticed that I think the cause of my problem, when I moved the cover here, I hadn't put this all back together. And I think I inadvertently broke this wire off, which is the wire to the aerial. So I think what ended up happening was I actually greatly reduced the effective range, and I think I was picking up noise that way. Either that or something else is going on, I'm not sure. Could also be that I had the cords wrapped kind of funny around the tripod, and I could have had the cords wrapped in a way so that they were picking up interference. I'm not quite sure what was going on. But that leads me to today's video, the immediate video, which is finishing this repair on this so I can screw this all back together, test it again, and if I still have trouble, I'm probably just going to can this whole thing and purchase a better quality lapel microphone setup. So anyways, what's left to do on this, really the only thing left to do is, remember that squelch potentiometer? I accidentally broke it, and this is a small 10K potentiometer that I snapped off right here. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to cannibalize this old Sony cassette radio, AM/FM cassette radio. I've had this thing for I don't know how many years, and it you know, the radio still plays perfectly fine, but the cassette mechanism hasn't worked in eons. I've got so many extra radios around, I really don't need this. I even had an older one than this kicking around here. If I find that one easy enough, I'll use that one. If not, we'll tear open this one. I already checked, and I took the knob off, and the shaft size seems correct as far as the right type of shaft for this knob to go on. So I think as long as I can find a potentiometer, again, because it's the squelch and not the volume, even if I'm close value-wise, if I find a 15K pot in this thing, I'm going to put it in here. And if it physically fits in there, I'm going to use it. Just get this thing, you know, knock this thing out. One less thing on the to-do list. Hey, I did find that other radio. Here it is. It's another Sony. This is a Sony model CFM-140. This is actually a cassette radio, AM/FM radio with cassette. This is in a stereo one. It's just a mono single speaker. And other than the handle being broken and the tip of the antenna being broken, this radio actually still works. And the cassette mechanism on this one probably doesn't work just because of the fact that the belts get all gummy and lose their elasticity over time. So this radio, if it wasn't for the broken handle, I would probably not cannibalize this radio because I actually have kind of a sentimental attachment to this radio. This radio and I have gone through quite a bit together. This radio, I bought this radio back in probably 1985 or 1986, and I bought this at the Army PX in Fort Riley, Kansas, and I wanted a small radio that I could take with me when we went out in the field for maneuvers, so this is what I ended up buying. And this radio has gone to desert training in California with me. This radio went to Germany with me in 1986 for what was called a reforger, which is return of forces to Germany. It was a major exercise. I believe it was the largest mobilization of the mechanized infantry to Germany since the end of World War II. So anyways, this thing's seen a lot of hours in the field. But, you know, it's really kind of beat up, and I can't get sentimental about it and keep everything, right? Otherwise you end up with, you know, a mess like this. So let's tear this one open. There's no tone control even on this thing. So all we get is a volume control, but it does look like it's going to be the right size potentiometer. I can get this knob off. I could probably get a peek down inside there and see whether or not it's got a threaded component to it. Can't quite see. Can't see the volume on this potentiometer, but I can see that it's quite a bit different design than this one. So unfortunately, I think that's going to be a fail. Well, I decided before I throw it out, I'll butcher it anyways, and I'll keep this board. So there's the potentiometer that's the wrong type of deal. This is actually the frame of the potentiometer. It has tabs that go down and are soldered to the board, and that's what actually gives it its mechanical strength. So there's no threaded area on here. I fear that the other one might be built the same way. Here's the cassette mechanism. It's amazing these things work at all. It's tiny little plastic gears, but it doesn't really have to do much. Most of the actual drive is done by the shaft right here, the tape being pinched between this shaft right here, which is called the capstan, and this roller right here. So this roller just freewheels, but gets pushed up, and the tape is squeezed between the two, and that's what drives it. The capstans drive by this big pulley right here, which is driven by this belt, which is really flimsy, And you can actually see, I don't know if you can catch that or not, but there's a spot there on the belt. It's got an imperfection because it's the belt is actually not moved in such a long time that when I did move it, it actually had the weird shape of the pulley still stuck in it. And then there's a secondary belt right here which drives this slip clutch, which is responsible for, depending on which mode it's in, either forward, reverse, rewind, or fast forwarding the tape, or driving the take-up reel, because as the capstan feeds the tape out, the take-up reel has to keep turning to coil it back on. Otherwise, it eats the tape. So when this stops moving, but this keeps moving, it'll eat the tape. Classic problem we used to have years ago. The power supply for this is it's a brute force power supply. Not a heck of a lot going on here. Got a step down transformer. We've got, we don't even have a bridge rectifier here. This isn't even a bridge. This is a full wave rectifier. We got two diodes there, two rectifying diodes, and we got a filter cap, 2200 microfarad at a whole 10 volts. So this is a really low voltage DC power supply. Nothing special about it, but I kind of like it self-contained on its own little board right here. And I could plug in a standard Sony type boombox cord into this, and I've got myself a low voltage DC supply, not a lot of power, but if I had a project I needed that for. And that is supposed to mimic the batteries, which this ran on 4C size batteries at a volt and a half a piece. So this is designed to run off of 6 volts. So I'm not sure what's coming out of here. Probably unloaded it would be a little higher. So I don't know, put it in my bag of tricks. I took a look at that other Sony radio I was going to take apart, and I could tell just through the taking the volume control knob off and looking inside, I could tell it was the same construction, so that wasn't going to work. And then I remembered that I thought I had a radio that might have the right kind of potentiometer in it over at the barn. So I just came back from the barn, and this might be the answer to my problem. This is a Panasonic table radio, I believe is what they call these. And believe it or not, I actually know the history of this one also. This is a radio that used to be in the kitchen of the house I grew up in for quite a few years. I believe I bought this radio when I was about 14 years old for my mom to replace the old tube type AM radio that had been sitting there. It's an old GE with a clock in it. An analog clock. It had been sitting there for, I don't know, ever since I could remember, since I was a little boy. And when it finally died, ended up getting her this radio at the music store that I used to work at. And so this is a Panasonic. So this would be a probably late 70s, early 80s vintage. And then somehow it ended up out in the garage where I was using it just to listen to music when I would be working on things out there or whatever. And then later in life it got abused and left. Unfortunately, it was left up against an outside wall in the barn where years of rain and snow and dirt have been coming through a broken window pane. So it doesn't have the original line cord on it. I can see that. That's a fine job I did there. I don't think OSHA would approve. Not up to code. So this thing should be garbage. But being that it's raining, we got a lot of precipitation that came in the past couple of days. It's finally stopped raining now, but this thing's soaking wet. So naturally, let's plug it in.
almost seems a sin to take this thing apart and trash it for a potentiometer. It still actually works. I can't believe that.
Horrible sight. I guess I found out for myself that everyone was right.
No one comes back from Dead Man's Curve. Well, this radio has come back from the dead, but I'm afraid that's still not going to be enough to save it from me. Oh, I can see the shaft is going to be longer. Oh, quite a bit. This goes in the trash. 8-ohm Japanese speaker. I recognize that symbol there. That is the symbol for Mashusta Electric Company of Japan. Spelt Matsushita, but my understanding is that the correct pronunciation was Mashusta. Save that line cord. It's only 100 years old. All right, time to get some soldering action going. I think while I'm waiting for my soldering iron to fire up, I'll message this gentleman that I was in communication with the past couple days, who has several woodworking tools for sale. Story is, supposedly they're liquidating an estate after the death of their father. And one of the items is a 14-inch Delta bandsaw, which I already have a 14-inch Delta bandsaw, but I use that one in my woodworking area, or I used to use it for woodworking. Now it just sits over there, but eventually I'm going to want to use it for woodworking again. And if I can get this one, I'll keep the better of the two for woodworking and convert the other one to a metalworking bandsaw. But the problem is I'm too cheap. So they didn't put any prices on the stuff. And when I asked, he said a bandsaw and a joiner. I'm sorry, a bandsaw and a lathe. $600. So I messaged back and I said, how much for just the bandsaw? And I got the old, well, we really don't know what it's worth. What do you want to offer? So in the end, I ended up giving a lowball offer. And I figured, hey, you know what? If he takes it, great. I'll make a special trip down today, pick it up. It's a 45-minute drive for me. But if it's that good of a deal, I'll go get it. And if they say no, well, the search continues. Because I know I'm going to find one somewhere when I least expect it and pay, you know, cheap money for it. Because, again, because I'm doing a conversion to it, I really don't care about, you know, if it's even got a motor on it or whatnot. I just want something that's got a good cast iron frame, like an old Walker Turner or an old Delta Rockwell, something like that. The other thing, though, about this one that I didn't take into account is it appears to have an aftermarket fence on it that looks like it might be some kind of fancy schmancy fence, because it's got blue anodized aluminum on it. Well, supposedly he was having people meet him today at 11 a.m. It's now 5 o'clock in the afternoon, so by now, if it was going to sell today, it will have sold. So let's just shoot a quick inquiry. Time to take what's left of the broken pot out of the PC board for the receiver. Need a little solder work to clean that up. Oh, I guess I should mention at this point I've got several things working against me here. Item number one, the potentiometer I just pulled out, is a 50k ohm potentiometer. And the one that I have broken here is a 10. But, you know what? I am Not going to worry about that. Plan to keep this squelch control pretty much probably in one position all the way over to one side anyways. Oh, so I did say I had a few things working against me. Problem number one is the wrong size potentiometer, but I'm going to just live with that. Problem number two is this is an on volume control. So it's got this little click because it actuates the switch on the back here. But I'm just going to ignore that. Voila. Problem number three is this is physically larger, so the spacing between these pins does not match the spacing between the holes on the board. Now that is a problem. But I think I might be able to finagle this with a couple of little tiny jumper wires. So see, there's a little hole right there. That little hole is where this little nub on the control pot is supposed to lock into, so that when you're putting torque on this knob turning it, it will arrest this from trying to turn and unscrew. So there is a lug on here similar to that, but it's in the wrong location. So if I were to put this in with that and get that in that hole right there, the connections actually will be facing that way. But you know what? That'll actually work probably to my advantage, because I could run three little short jumper wires up here. But because this is the squelch circuit, this shouldn't have, I don't believe this will have audio signal on it, so I think it'll be kind of happy to just sit there. With those little extra wires on, I don't think I have to worry about stray noise and garbage being an issue. But for starters, I can't get this in because this went down through a hole in the PC board. So these are facing the wrong way. So I need to move these very carefully. Let's see, how far apart, how close is this? Yeah, see, that would not work. All right, so I am definitely going to have to do a jumper wire deal here. So hopefully I can twist these up without breaking them off. I should buy a lottery ticket because I lucked out there. Okay, the size of the hole in this little metal shield right here is not large enough for this tab to go through. So I could drill this hole a little larger. But you know what, if I drill the hole a little larger, this is soldered on here. I really don't feel like going through the trouble of taking this off of here to drill a hole in it. Not to mention, it's so close to the edge right there. If I drill a hole, I'm going to break right through anyways. I'm going to weaken this whole thing. So I think what instead, I'll just take a file and I will file down this tab to make it a little narrower. Well, that might be a little tricky also. Difficult, but not impossible. It's going to be easier to do this with a little Dremel grinding attachment, I think. I mean, I could do it with a file, except that as I'm stroking with the file, I'm going to be hitting the end of the file here and damaging these threads. I could damage the threads much quicker by slipping and in a fraction of a second touching this. Yeah, you know what? Why don't I put something around that? He has some tape here. Not a huge amount of protection. Better than nothing, though. Oh, sure. Perfect. Now we're just going to make me three little jumper wires.